Oh, yeah, that's Scott. And so, just to remind you, I was told somebody put that. Just to remind you, in the last class, we were talking about covariant differentiation. We started discussing the notion of a parallel transport of vectors of one form. And we talked about how that in order for us to be able to differentiate things in a covariant manner, we need some object that helps us transport vectors of one forms or other tensors parallelly. And that object was called the Christoffel symbol, gamma mu alpha beta. And the operator formula was delta A mu is equal to gamma mu zeta beta A beta delta x zeta. So this allowed us to transport the one form A mu from x to x plus delta x. Okay? And then we deduced that if this was the right rule for an index down, the correct rule for an index up was equal to gamma zeta alpha mu A zeta delta x alpha. This had a plus sign, this had a minus sign. Although this distinction is going to be completely unimportant in 10 minutes, at the moment, please remember that the right index, this gamma has one index up and two indices down. The index on the right contracts with the spatial separation, while the index on the left is associated with the vector. Okay, as we're going to see, for much of what we're going to do in this course, this distinction will soon be moot. Basically, because we will see that then we also talked about how we could parallel transport objects of many indices up and many indices down just by compounding this rule many times, index by index. Here we'll try out the formula again. And finally, we discussed how we could define the covariant derivative of, let's say, one form. Okay? And the covariant derivative formula was del mu of A alpha was equal to d mu of A alpha minus gamma gamma alpha mu theta in here. Okay? The index having to do with how much you move in space is on the right. The index having to do with the vector field is on the left. As I say, this will be important. Is important for semantics at the moment, I mean for logic at the moment, and is actually important in general relativity when you have fermions. But soon, for most of what we do in this course, this distinction will soon be important. Okay, right at the end of the last class, we then used this, we said that this covariant derivative has to transform covariantly under a coordinate change. That's why we introduced it. Okay, so this, we use this to deduce what transformation properties will mean in for this gamma symbol. Okay? And what we concluded was that under a covariant, under a coordinate change, gamma tilde alpha beta gamma, there must be, goes to what, or is equal to what? Is equal to a path that transforms with a tensor. Okay? So, del x zeta 1 del x zeta 2 by del y beta by del y gamma del y by del x alpha, that's called zeta 3, and then gamma zeta 3 and zeta 1 zeta 2. This is how the transformation will happen if this gamma tilde was a tensor. And as usual, you must remember that this guy is a function of x of y. But I don't write that unless we need it, just to keep the formula not so cumbersome. Okay? But in addition to this, there was one more piece to the transformation rule. And that was this. So the piece that went like del x alpha by del y del 2x by del y beta del y gamma. Okay, not exactly that. It was del x theta. And then this was compounded by del y alpha by this part is the inhomogeneous part. You know, the shift in this is not proportional to gamma. You know, this part is just a rotation of the original gamma, like it is. This part is inhomogeneous. Okay? So we've got this object gamma that we've defined, and that must obey this transformation property. Now all this so far sounds like abstract mathematics. You know, it's mathematicians who say, let us introduce an object gamma into our theory that has this transformation property. It's not the typical way physicists behave, you know, for good reason. So you should be feeling very uncomfortable with all of this. And this discomfort should leave you only once you have an explicit formula for gamma in terms of the fields of the problem being the metric. That's what we're shooting towards. Or an explicit statement that there is a new degree of freedom in the game apart from the metric. That would be a possibility, but it would be less economical. You know, we'll define Einstein's theories that that's neat. Okay. So, now let's look at this transformation formula for the start. The first thing you note is that there's a tensor part and an inhomogeneous part. But the inhomogeneous part is manifestly symmetric in beta and in the bottom two indices of gamma. What does that tell you? That tells you that if you take this gamma and split it up into an anti-symmetric piece and a symmetric piece. And who can stop you from doing that? Then, the anti-symmetric part transforms like a tensor. Okay? So you can think of gamma as being composed as a part that is anti-symmetric in its bottom two indices, and a part that is symmetric in its bottom two indices. And this anti-symmetric part transforms like a tensor. Okay. Now, as we go along in our study, the symbol gamma will enter the local equations of motion of many things. Okay? And we want it. We want our theory to be such that motivated by the kind of motivations that we had at the beginning of this course, the equivalence principle. Okay? We want our theory to be such that it's possible to choose a coordinate system in which everything looks like flat space for a local equation. Okay? So we want our theory to be such that it's possible to be able to choose a coordinate system to transform gamma to zero. Now, if you've got a tensor that is non-zero in any one coordinate system, it's non-zero in every coordinate system. Because the linear transformation, transformation rule for tensors is just linear. You can't take something non-zero and make them zero by a linear transformation, unless you do something singular. Okay? So that tells you that the equivalence principle, as we originally stated it, you know, wanting these local equations of motion to be like that in flat space, cannot really be true unless either all local equations don't depend on the anti-symmetric part of gamma, in which case we shouldn't need to care about anything. Or if for some reason or the other the anti-symmetric part of gamma was zero. Okay? Now the anti-symmetric part of gamma has a name. And the name is called the torsion. Landau-Lipschitz very strangely called it the curvature of space. It's a very strange bit of notation, terminology, since we're going to use that word for something else. It's almost like two different editions and they forgot to change the terminology. Anyway, most people call this the torsion of space. Okay, the anti-symmetric part of gamma. And we're going to proceed with the assumption that we're going to try that our torsion is zero. We're going to try to find a zero. Now, I should say immediately that it will turn out that when you start doing physics properly, that is, introducing fermions into general relativity, we will find that this assumption is not valid. In the presence of fermions, though we may not get to that in this course, the effective spin connection of space develops a torsion, one that is sort of determined by what the fermions are doing. Okay? So, though we will not see it in this course, this assumption is not always correct. But we're going to make it, and we won't encounter a problem with this assumption most of what we're going to do in this course. Okay?
How is this justified?
It's, you know, it's okay. Let's say it this way. What we want to do is to introduce an object that will make derivatives transform covariantly. Now, as we've seen, is only this. What was the problem? The problem was this inhomogeneous term in the derivative transformation. Actually, as we've seen, the only part of gamma that comes into play in helping you cancel this inhomogeneous term is the symmetric part. Okay? So you can think of this as a minimalist assumption. You know, any assumption you make on gamma that is so strong that it will not help you make your covariant derivatives covariant is a stupid thing. Okay? But, although we've introduced this in general, suppose gamma were symmetric in its bottom two indices, then it would still be possible to make an object that transforms covariantly, a covariant derivative that transforms covariantly, because gamma has to have, you know, the transformation rule for gamma would not spoil the symmetry. Okay, so we could try to create maybe a theory in which there was also an anti-symmetric part of gamma, and sometimes you would be forced to. Okay, but the minimal thing would be, since we can set it to zero, nothing forces us to keep it from zero, let's set it to zero.
Yes. Coordinate
this is a coordinate invariant thing because the anti-symmetric part of gamma transforms like a tensor.
This also implies the transformation should be linear, the constant times.
Yes, this transformation is linear in the sense that it's not linear and homogeneous, but it's linear. Yes. We derive this. The transformation rule for gamma, whether gamma was symmetric or anti-symmetric, is this. Let me say this again. You know, this is the kind of thing that you would. If you were trying to build a theory, you would most naturally do this. Because what you want to do is to generalize the notion of a derivative in the smallest way you can, in the least way you can, so as to be consistent with covariance. Okay? And it's consistent to make the generalization with gamma symmetric. So let's forget about the anti-symmetric part for a bit, unless something forces us to turn it on. Is this fine?
Gamma, we define them as how the way parallel transport happens. Is that it's not clear why that.
But we don't have an independent notion of how parallel transport happens. You see, we are going to try to define how parallel transport happens in an arbitrary manifold. We don't have, you know, it's not like there is a physically correct way that we have a prior notion of parallel transport that we're trying to find a formula for. We're trying to make a definition of this parallel.
Basically, what cases are we excluding when we put this to zero?
Essentially, coupling the bonds.
No, I mean, in parallel transport, in a visual sense, what sort of?
In a visual sense. Okay. Product for the GVS with the tangent. So what about this?
that's a good answer.
Yeah, we don't. There may be many criteria you have in your mind, and anything reasonable that you have will be fulfilled by what we come up with. But I'm saying that at the moment, given the manifold, one could, just as a mathematician, endow the manifold with the notion of parallel transport. That notion of parallel transport, a priori, will have nothing to do with it. Okay? What we are going to try to do now is to find a reasonably natural notion of parallel transport. Okay? That we will find a formula for from the metric. Okay? And we're going to try to do this in a minimalistic way. Okay. Yes.
But Kama-Mu-Nyu can be independent of that. That's right.
So that's why the Parabini model and... Yes, so as you say, once we turn on fermions, we will need to have this kind, you know, fermion Lagrangians need to work, you need to work with these Einsteins and spin connections. For bosons, it's equal. Okay. Okay. So let me just say it again. What we are trying to do is to invent a notion of parallel transport. Okay? That we make the covariant derivative transform covariant. That for that what we need is to endow our spacetime with some object that transforms like this. That's what we want. Okay? For this purpose, the antisymmetric part of gamma is irrelevant. Okay? If I choose a gamma which is completely symmetric, you add something anti-symmetric to it and make that anti-symmetric transform like a tensor. Okay? That will equally well be a good notion of parallel transport. Okay? But we don't need the anti-symmetric term to cancel an inhomogeneous space in this transformation. So the minimalist assumption would be that this anti-symmetric part is zero. Okay? I want to emphasize that there isn't an a prior notion of parallel transport. We're trying to define. Okay? So we're going to go with this assumption and see what we can now say about it. Is this clear? Any questions about it? Okay. Now, the next thing that we're going to require about our notion of parallel transport is that it is what is called metric compatible. That is, that the covariant derivative the covariant derivative of the metric tensor is zero. Now, why do we require this? You can motivate this in many ways. But one of which is, you know, one simple motivation is this. Look, suppose we've got a metric that the one-form A mu can be transformed to a vector A mu. Well, let's do the other way. A vector A mu can be transformed to a one-form A mu by contraction with the metric. Thank you. Okay. Now, this is of course a very natural correspondence. Given a metric, there's very natural correspondence between a one-form and a vector. And you might want this correspondence to be respected by differentiation. Okay. So, what you might ask is that if you take the covariant derivative of A mu, and then, so now this is two tensor, and then you raise this index, G mu zeta. This gives you some B zeta alpha. There's some tensor with one upper index and one lower index. Okay? You might require, suppose we put the demand. Okay. That this object here is the same thing as the covariant derivative acting on this integer. D of D, okay, let's call this theta. Okay, now all objects in here are completely defined. This is a tensor, this is a vector, and something I think was an exercise for you to convince yourself of is that our rules for covariant differentiation obey the Leibniz rule. That is, the derivative of A times B is derivative of A times B plus derivative of, you know, A times derivative of B. Okay? So, using that fact, this thing becomes d alpha g mu beta. So here I had a covariant derivative of A mu with one index raised, and I wanted that this is the same as this with the free index here is zeta. Sorry. This is the thing that I want. Okay? But this quantity here is equal to d alpha of g. Let me look at this side. This quantity here is g mu zeta of d alpha of g mu theta a theta. Okay? Where d acts in this place. And we want to check whether or not this is equal to that. Now there are two terms here. The first term with this d acts on the a, and the second term with the d acts on the g, because of the Leibniz rule. Now, the term with the d acts on the a is exactly what we want. Why is that? That's because we get a g inverse mu zeta multiplying a g mu theta. Okay? Which gives us a factor of delta zeta theta. Okay? So it just converts this theta index to zeta. Okay? And that's what we want. Okay? However, the term that we don't want, the additional term is something we don't want. That additional term is proportional to the covariant derivative of the metric. Okay? So this property that it doesn't matter whether you raise indices before or after taking the covariant derivative. If you make this demand, it seems like a reasonably natural demand to make of your notion of parallel transport to make it come up compatible with the metric. Okay? Then, if you make this demand, then you require that the covariant derivative of the metric is zero. Okay? And you require, all components of the covariant derivative, as you can convince. Okay, excellent. So, now we know two things about about our notion of this parallel transport, this gamma symbol. Firstly, that it's symmetric. And secondly, that it's compatible with the metric so that the covariant derivative of the metric is zero. Now this is enough to actually explicitly determine. What you want is a notion of parallel transport. You see, given a metric, an object with an upper index is the same as an object with a lower index. You can take an object with an upper index, convert it to an object with a lower index by just pulling down with a factor of g. Now, what you want is that this equivalence between upper and lower indices commutes with their differentiation. So whether you take the derivative of the upper index guy, or take the derivative of the lower index guy and then raise the index, you get the same answer. Okay? This is the condition that somehow ties the metric up to your notion of parallel transport. Mathematically, these are separate things. You could have one notion of parallel transport, another notion of the metric, and you're not forced to link them. If something good will happen, clearly, you know, these two things are linked. So it's a natural requirement to make. Okay? Fine. Now, this now is sufficient to completely detect. These two assumptions, the symmetry of gamma and the compatibility of parallel transport with the metric, are completely sufficient, are sufficient to completely determine them as a function in terms of the metric. Okay? So let me write down the following three equations. Okay. Firstly, I want to write down the equation dl. Okay, I'm going to use capital letters because my small l's and small i's are indistinguishable. G. Maybe my big ones are also. Okay. This is a true equation. Okay, and I'll write down all the other three. Okay, I'll write down. Wait. K, like K. Okay, so now let me write down the other three. So, dk, g, I, l, and d, l, k, I, g, l, k. This is easy. All these are true equations. Now let me take these equations and write them out. Okay? So, this equation here is del by del xl. Well, let me write this del, because we're not working two different coordinates, it's just one coordinate. G I k is equal to, it's tough with minus sign, so I'll write this equal to plus l, right? And what is it? We have gamma of I L, let's say M, G, M, K, okay, plus gamma of K, L, I put an M, G, I, M.
So, actually this principle, I mean, overhead derivative with G, which can this be, locally the G remains same as the laws of physics remain invariant locally.
You're asking, could the principle of equivalence be violated?
Good question.
Would the principle of equivalence somehow be violated if this was not true? Good question. Thank you about that. Well, you know, in the end, what we're going to do, you see, let me say what we're actually going to do. What we're actually going to do is to write down some sort of a Lagrangian to describe motion and derive the equations of motion from that Lagrangian. Okay? The real justification for what I'm saying is the following, that the equations of motion will turn out to involve a covariant derivative built out of G in the way that I'm talking about. Okay. So now your question could be, is there some way of writing down a Lagrangian where it would involve some other covariant derivative? You see, in the absence of sufficient structure, probably. Basically, because you need, the most general gamma, okay, is the gamma wave and right gamma, plus a tensor built out of three indices. And there are no tensors built out of three indices with only the metric tensor. Okay, as we will see, we'll completely investigate the set of all tensors you can build out of just the metric. So you will need some other structure. You will need some other matter fields or something like that. With which you can naturally associate this anti-symmetric part of gamma. And this is what will happen with fermions, but in the simplest cases. Okay.
Yeah. Will that quadrant derivative of metric be zero for every metric or just the metrics that are obtained by transform of that?
Every metric. We require this to just be always true. Because in an arbitrary space-time manifold, we want the notion of upper and lower to be the same. Okay? So that's why we're putting this as an identity. This formula here must just be true for our arbitrary metric. Okay, great. Now let's write down this formula with these indices cycled around. So here what have we got? Here what we've done is exchange the indices k and n. So del k g I l. And what's the rule? Interchange k and l. So it's gamma I k m g m l plus gamma k and l. K and l. Okay. L k doesn't do much. M g I. Okay? And finally, I'll write down this other formula, but I'll write it down with a minus sign, because I'm going to want to add all these three with a minus sign, so watch me. So I'll write down the formula with di gamma lk, glk. Okay, now this is simply obtained by interchanging from the first one, we interchange I and L. Okay, I here and N here. So let's write that down. So that's equal to minus gamma Li M G M K minus gamma I and L, so K I M G L M. Okay, these are all true equations. Okay. Now, suppose I take these equations and I take these equations and I add them all together. Okay. So I get del L of G I K plus del K of G I L. Minus del I of G L K. What do I get? Okay, so let's see. So I'm going to tell you what we get, and then rather than we try to justify. What we should get is 2 times gamma L K M G M I. Okay, let's see if this works. So, firstly, anything with indices at the bottom that are not L and K should cancel. So let's circle those that are L and K. This one is L and K. This one is L and K. Okay. Now, this guy and this guy are, of course, identical. They add up to give us the W root. Okay. What about the guy with I and L? The guy with I and L becomes symmetric. It's the same as the guy with L and I. But this occurs with the minus sign. So this cancels that. What about the guy with I and K? Similarly, because of symmetry. Okay. This is the same as this, so this cancels that. Okay? So we've shown that this equation is true. Now, this is great because we've got a formula now with only gammas on the right-hand side, with only a single gamma up to a G. So that gives us a formula for gamma. It tells us that gamma of LK M is equal to half del L of GK of GKM plus del K of GLM plus del M of GLK, the whole thing raised with GM O's. This should have been N. Is this clear? solution for gamma is a function of g. Now, just let's go back for a moment and see why we could solve for gammas as a function of g's. Let's do the counting that told us that it had to be the case. How many gammas do we have? Does somebody count the number of independent components of gamma in four dimensions? Okay, first tell me, without the assumption of symmetry, how many we have? Exactly. Oh, 4 into 4 into 4. 64. Yes, 64. Yes, 4 into 4 into 4 would have been the right answer. 64 without the assumption of symmetry. Now, with the assumption of symmetry, how many? Now, what? What is that? 32. No.
24.
No. 24. Huh? Somebody do this counting, right? Come on.
24.
No!
40.
Somebody said 40.
40.
The number of indices at the bottom is the number of symmetric indices from four indices. So it's 4 into 5 by 2. That's 10. The thing at the top has nothing to do with that at the bottom. That's 4 more. So 4 into 10. 40 independent components of gas. Okay? How many independent first derivatives of the metric are? 40. It's the same counting. You've got one derivative and then two symmetric indices. So 4 into 10. So you have 40 first derivatives of the metric, 40 independent components of gamma, and the fact that the covariant derivative of g is 0 gives you linear relationship between these linear relations between these 40 different objects. The 40 objects that are the first derivative of the metric and the 40 objects that are the gammas. So clearly you can solve for one term to the other. Okay? Had we not made this assumption of symmetry, how would the counting have gone? There would have been 64 independent components of gamma and 40 first derivatives of the metric. Had we not made the assumption of symmetry and still asserted this, what would we have done? We could have solved for 40 out of the 64 independent gammas in terms of first derivatives of the metric. But the remaining parts would have been undetermined. What parts would have been undetermined? Precisely the anti-symmetric parts of gamma. How many components are there in the anti-symmetric parts of gamma? 24. That's right, because 64 minus 40. And can somebody independently do the counting for me?
6 into 4. 6 into 4.
Well, 4 into 6, exactly. The number of anti-symmetric combinations of 4 and x objects is 4 into 3 by 2, so that's 6. 6 into 4 is the number. Okay? So it's precisely the anti-symmetric parts of gamma that would have been left undetermined by this condition. And the assumption that that anti-symmetric part is 0 is what allowed us to completely determine gamma. You see, by the way, that great. So you see, what we've basically done is make the minimal assumption. The minimal assumption consistent with having a notion of covariant differentiation. That gives us enough power to completely determine our gammas in terms of. Okay, so now this gamma is not an abstract object anymore. Okay, it's a completely concrete object. You know the metric kind of gamma. Correct. So I know what my notion of parallel transport means. I've determined it by putting physically reasonable criteria on this notion of parallel transport. As I say, later on in the course, it will turn out that this notion of parallel transport enters the equations of physics. We will write down Lagrangians there's some circularity here. Up to some potential circularity, it will turn out that that's what happened. We'll see it.
Can we do the opposite? Choose a gamma and then find the metric?
Yes. Yeah, well, we can find the first derivatives of the metric. Good. That's a very good question. Okay. So, So the question, Pratyush's question was, suppose you specify a set of gammas. Okay? Now, think of these as differential equations for the metric. Okay? Can you solve this? Now, firstly, suppose I give you an arbitrary set of potential gammas. Okay? Can you always solve the equation that these are these first derivatives of the metric? No, you cannot. Why not? Somebody tell me.
To get those conditions.
What?
LGIT.
No, those are the things you will impose. Okay, what you would do is to say, well, I know I've got my gamma, then I'll treat these as differential equations to try to solve for the metric. Okay? But if you give arbitrary gammas, you can't do this. Why not? Not boundary, it's much more basic. See, suppose, let me take a little toy analog, okay, which is much simpler. But suppose I want to determine a function A by specifying its derivative. So I give you d theta of A. And then I tell you d theta of A is A, is some b theta. If I know A, I can take its derivative and specify b theta. But suppose I specify d theta, can I always find an A such that del theta of A is b theta?
Mixed derivative.
More than the constants, right? There's an integrability condition. You see, this is four differential equations determining one function. That's too much. In general, there's no solution. Okay? You could take the first of these equations and integrate it. You get an answer. You could take the second of these equations, integrate it, you get an answer. How do you know these equations are? The answers are consistent. Okay, and the integrability condition is that the curl of b theta is 0.
D phi b theta minus d theta b phi is 0.
Which is obvious from the left hand side, but it's not true for arbitrary b fields. Okay? So if you just try to specify a set of gammas, it'll be very simple. Okay. Once again, you can try to take second derivatives. You know, both ways. You get a large number of integrability conditions on gammas for this to be solved. Yeah, just another way of saying it is that, you know, specifying all gammas is like specifying all 40 first derivatives of the metric. That's 40 differential equations to determine 10 functions. It's too much. So there's the tight constraints for it to be. But of course, if those consistency conditions are obeyed, then you would be able to use that. You'd be able to then solve for metric dimensions. Okay, excellent. Other questions about this?
So this is always invertible, right?
What?
You can all system of linear equations.
Yes. You can always that's what we've done in fact. We wrote the original equations that we wrote were expressions for derivative of a metric in terms of gammas. And by doing this manipulation, we've inverted these equations. We've written gammas in terms of derivatives. So we've explicitly inverted. So unless you know something is singular here. Yes?
One thing was that d alpha of g mu is equal to 0.
Yes.
Somehow related to the local tightness of
D alpha.
Yeah, you know, the local flatness we will define in terms.
Is there something more independent?
No, you know, if you were just a mathematician, you could define a notion of parallel transport independent of the metric. Now, with any notion of parallel transport, you would be able to set the metric to eta and gamma to zero, as we've said. So I think not my answer is not directly connected. Not directly connected, but you know. Not directly connected. I can't immediately see them.
That equation, you have a notion of parallel transport where it pushes gamma to be 0. Then del alpha g mu nu would be 0.
What?
In that coordinate system, according to that.
If you assume these equations are true.
No. That equation. D alpha g mu.
This one?
Yeah. I mean, if you have, even if you don't connect the metric and.
No. But we're asserting this equation is the assertion of the connection. You see, we've got two different notions in our head.
Yeah.
One notion of parallel transport, another notion is that of the metric. Mathematically, they're distinct. You know, there are two different, you could mathematically consider a manifold with a particular notion of parallel transport and two different metrics. And this is something mathematicians do all the time. It's not a totally weird thing. Okay? This is the simplest thing to do. follow from it. And as you will see, as you will see, the action that we started with, that is the action for the motion of a particle, will naturally involve this, will turn out to involve this notion of differentiation. Okay? So, you start with the natural action of physics and this will come out. Yes?
Yes.
At least until we start looking at the dynamics of gravity itself, this is not circular. We get a little circular once we start. Okay, good. So now we have this nice notion of parallel transport. Yeah?
We have two cases where we have infinitely defined the matrix.
Yes.
And without going into the Christoph symbols, we can derive the Riemann tensor, Ricci tensor, and the Ricci scalar.
Well, those formulas for the Riemann tensor, Ricci tensor, and so on use gammas. Well, there's a formula for the Ricci tensor, which is given in terms of gammas. And then, if you use this formula for gammas, then you're assuming this connection between the metric and parallel transport. So I'm saying that the your formula for the Ricci tensor and so on, the standard formula makes this assumption because it's given in terms of these gammas.
But that's what my question was.
Yes.
If there are two sets of situations where the metric is known and other set, the
parallel transport properties are. Yes. So can we independently derive
the
Ricci tensor and the properties of the space-time
without
knowing
the, in one case the parallel transport properties, or
for
the other case the
GPU? So you're asking, what is the connection between the notion of curvature and the notion of parallel transport? Is this clear? Okay. Now, as we'll see with this definition, connection, curvature and parallel transport are tightly connected. That's right. So, curvature will be linked to the following question. How does, let's say, a vector change when you parallel transport under a small loop? That the answer to that question will be given in terms of curvature. Suppose you had an independent notion of parallel transport, but you use the usual formulas of curvature given in terms of the metric, the ones that are exposed. Then, this connection between how a vector changes under a small loop and curvature would be broken. Okay? It's when you have parallel transport defined through these formulas that the formula for how something parallel transports under a small loop being given by curvature will be maintained. Okay? So, there is a connection between curvature and this notion of parallel transport coming from this connection. But everything good relating parallel transport to curvature will happen only with this notion of parallel transport. For those of you who don't know what curvature is, you'll see what it's meant. Okay, excellent. Fine. Now, there are many exercises involving these gammas and covariant derivatives built out of them that I meant to do in class. But because of the seminar and because of all your excellent questions, we've gone slower than I had hoped to. So I'm going to give these to you as exercises. These will be in our first problem set. Okay. Let me just list the exercises that I would like you to do. I would like you to do. Okay. Demonstrate that. Gamma I K is equal to half G I M del I M del X. Umesh, please note this. Okay. And then N is equal to the first thing is basically obvious from definition.
Del X.
Okay, so this is the first thing. This is obvious. This is the thing you're missing. Okay. Using this, show that okay, so just the 2-3 more algebraic things.
What, show that G K L gamma K L I.
Okay, so this is a result for contracting one upper and one lower index. Okay, it's got a nice expression in terms of the derivative of the metric. Now I want a result for contracting two lower indices of one. Can't contract two lower indices, you can only contract them through a metric. So let us print this is equal to minus 1 by square root of minus g d by d xk of square root of minus g g I. Okay, then demonstrate that the covariant divergence of any vector, that is di of ai, is equal to, is given by a simple form. 1 by okay, so one last thing, as a corollary to to this statement, show us a corollary to this statement, that which is beneath it, that that del m del m of a scalar is given by 1 by square root of minus g, del m times df square root of minus g, g m n del n. Yes?
Is ignoring the anti-symmetric part related to the fact that gravity won't act at all on the system? I'm not sure about this. And will it awfully act on the existence of certain magnetic fields?
You know, I mean, of course, a gravitational force can put a torque on a system. Oh, wait, you're saying with the center of mass. Yeah, you may be right. You may be right that that this would send something rotating, that you wouldn't be able to move to a coordinate frame in which this thing doesn't start rotating. Yeah, this could be right. I would have to check. I would have to think.
For moving along the geodesic, an object won't start rotating.
This may be right. This may be right. You have to be totally right. This may be right. But you know, suppose we were just talking about. Just talking about the motion of a particle. This anti-symmetric term basically would be forced to be zero. Okay? Basically because there's nothing else it could be. If the only field is enough. You know, when we wrote down the action for the motion of a particle, the action was written in terms of the metric. There was no gamma in it. So any equation of motion that we get will be written in terms of the metric. Okay? So now you can ask, is there any object, any three-index object, two of whose indices are anti-symmetric, okay, then you can form out of the metric that transforms like a tensor. And the answer to that mathematical question is, okay, it's a completely unambiguous mathematical question, because we know the metric transforms, we know what its derivatives transform. The answer to that mathematical question is no. So just from knowing the answer to this mathematical question, we know that the motion of a particle governed by this square root minus g action that we're going to be started with could only involve this notion of gamma. Okay. I think you're probably right that that in situations where this torsion is turned on, it would involve local rotations of objects in a way that can't be transformed the way we're doing. That's probably. Okay, good. Any questions or comments about these exercises? Okay, these are all extremely simple algebraic exercises. It's good for you to do them to get familiar with manipulating these Dhamma symbols. I've listed all of these because these are all results people use as we go along. Okay, so one of these exercises, just to say, you see, if you wanted to compute the divergence, you know, suppose you're doing a practical calculation. If you wanted to compute the divergence of a vector field, you might think, well, what I have to do first is to determine all 40 gamma symbols. And then use the formula that somebody has given me to compute the divergence of the vector field. That's a laborious process. It's laborious in practice. It's also a laborious conception. Because then, in your head, the divergence of the vector field becomes some complicated mess. Okay? However, the end result of the process is something much simpler. It's just this object. You do what you would have done in flat space, just take the derivatives, ordinary derivatives of these components, but put a factor of square root g inside, and compensate by dividing by a factor of square root g outside. Okay? Now this simplicity for vector fields applies to anti-symmetric tensors of all rank. That's what this exercise is. Okay? Now, how important was anti-symmetry? Suppose we're trying to do the same thing for a symmetric two-index vector. Symmetric to index sense. Do you get the same answer? Well, you get a piece that's the same. That's this part. But you get something else that's a little more complicated. That involves explicitly the first derivatives of different components of the entry. Contracting with tensor. Okay. These kind of results will be important when we study Maxwell's equations. Because Maxwell's equations are full of anti-symmetric tensors. This equation will of course be important when we study the gravitational equations themselves, because we'll need to take the covariant derivative of a stress tensor. Okay? Oh, and one last thing I wanted you to check, sorry, I forgot, there's a sixth exercise. That is that d mu of a mu minus d mu of a mu is equal to d mu a mu. That is, when you take covariant derivatives and anti-symmetrize on one form, it's the same as anti-symmetrizing ordinary derivatives. Okay? And that this is true if for arbitrary number of indices, downstairs indices, if all the indices are anti-symmetric, are mutually anti-symmetric. Okay, this is the last exercise. Okay? So this tells you that something like the field strength in Maxwell electrodynamics, which is d mu a nu minus d mu a nu, continues to be given by the same formula as in flat space. That is automatically covariant. You don't need the metric to define the field strength. But you will need the metric to get the full equation for motion. Okay, fine. I'm going to take a clip. Is anyone hard pressed for time? Can I take 5 or 10 minutes extra? Okay, fine. So now with all these exercises out of the way, there's one last thing I wanted to do algebraically before trying to deny for you the equation of motion of a particle moving around in a metric. So the last algebraic thing was to justify the statement that I've often made, that I made at the beginning of the class, that it is possible to find a coordinate frame in which both the metric becomes eta, the Minkowski and standard in eta, as well as the first derivatives of the metric vanish at any given point in space. Okay? That you can set the metric to be eta at a point is obvious. Okay. Why is it obvious? So what is the rule for the transformation of a metric? The rule for the transformation of a metric is by acting by a symmetric matrix, acting on that metric, and by that symmetric matrix transpose. Is this clear? Is the statement clear? Let me write that. So G tilde is equal to alpha beta is del y beta by del x alpha. Sorry. Del x theta by del y alpha. G theta phi del x phi by del y beta. Now if you think of this as a matrix, G is a matrix, and this x to y Jacobian as another matrix, then this becomes the equation G is equal to J, G, J transpose. Okay? Where G is a symmetric real matrix. Okay. Now, all of you are familiar with the theorem in mathematics that a symmetric real matrix can be diagonalized by an orthogonal similarity transformation. Okay? Now, what we're doing with J is not a similarity transformation. It's J, not J inverse. It's J, J transpose. But when the similarity transformation is orthogonal, it's the same as doing J, J transpose. Okay? So, there are many more elementary ways to justify it, but just quoting something you know. It's clear that at the point, we can do a coordinate change to take G to eta. This part is obvious. Okay? Now, let's take this point to be the origin. Okay? So, the kind of coordinate change that we're doing to take G to eta at the origin is a linear coordinate change. Okay? What we did was something like x mu is equal to a mu nu x nu. Because we want the constant matrix, okay, to do the diagonalization. We didn't want any x involved. We were only interested in what happens at the origin. Okay? This coordinate change that we've done sets the metric to eta, but leaves the first derivatives of the metric arbitrary. Now I want to demonstrate that it is simultaneously possible to make the metric eta and also set the first derivative of the metric to be zero at the origin. In order to demonstrate that, what I have to demonstrate, I mean, it's equivalent to demonstrate that I can set the metric to be eta and set all gammas to zero. Because gammas are linearly related to the first derivative of the metric. Okay? Now, so suppose I first got a coordinate, I've first chosen coordinates to set the metric at that point to be eta. What further coordinate change can I do that will not spoil the fact that the metric is eta at that point, but will set all the gammas to zero? That's easy. Firstly, we don't want to spoil, we want to make sure that we don't spoil the metric being zero, being eta at that point. That will be true if we make the coordinate change higher order in x's than linear. Suppose we make the coordinate change in particular, this is what we need, quadratic in x's. Then this derivative matrix, del x by del y, when evaluated at the origin, will simply give us zero for these additional coordinate changes. Okay? So for all, so what I'm going to try to do is to find a coordinate change of the form x alpha is equal to x is equal to y alpha plus gamma alpha plus at the moment a alpha beta beta x theta y beta y. I'm going to look for such a coordinate change. Any such coordinate change will not affect the value of any tensor at the origin, because it will involve taking a derivative and then at the end of that process setting y to zero. So this part just doesn't contribute for tensors. Okay? But gamma doesn't transform like a tensor. In particular, the transformation properties for gamma involve two derivatives of x with respect to y. So we could try to choose this a to set gamma to zero. Okay? So suppose that we had some gamma here. Okay? How will it transform under this kind of coordinate change? So gamma tilde will be equal to gamma, that's the tensor transformation part. Plus what? Plus, we had a nice formula. We had del, okay, so let's put indices alpha, beta, theta. Alpha, beta, theta. Plus del x alpha, x, m, del 2 y alpha del y beta, and then del y alpha by del x m times alpha beta beta. Thank you. Let's plug in this business. So we're going to evaluate all formulas at the origin. So this guy at the origin is just the delta function. Right? Because you get a term from here, which gives you the delta function. A term from here, which at the origin is zero. Okay? So this we can just replace by gamma beta theta alpha plus del 2 x alpha by del y beta del y. Okay. Now, so what we want to do is to find some a that will do this job. So let's plug in what this object is from here. So what this object is gamma beta beta alpha plus twice a alpha beta. So to be Thank you. Alright, so there's a very simple coordinate change. Just choose A alpha beta theta to be equal to gamma alpha beta theta by 2. With a minus. Okay? So we make this choice, plug into here. So the coordinate change, x alpha is y alpha minus gamma beta theta by 2, sets gamma to 0. It has not affected the value of any tensor field at the origin, so it doesn't affect the fact that g was equal to eta. So we demonstrated that we can find a coordinate system, we can find a coordinate change to set both the metric to standard form to eta and the first derivatives of the metric to 0 at any given point. Actually, there is a stronger result, which I will not now try to prove unless we need it. It says that along any open curve, you can always set gamma to 0. So you can do more than just at a point. You can do it along any open curve. But at the moment, I will not try to prove this because we don't know. Okay, questions or comments on this? Okay. So, now the last thing we're going to try to do in today's lecture is to try to see how these abstract, all these abstract mathematical constructions that we've done enter physics. So in the simple Lagrangian that we started the lectures with, namely the Lagrangian that dictates the motion of a free particle under the influence of gravitation. Okay, so let's go back to the formula we first started the lectures with. The formula being, we've got an action which takes the form square root of minus m square root of minus g alpha beta del dx alpha by d lambda dx beta by d lambda. Okay? Now what I'm going to try to do is to derive the equations of motion that follow from this action. Okay? And just see what it means. So the equations of motion are completely determined by an action. You don't need any notion of parallel transport or anything fancy. It gives you some equations of motion. Let's see what it is, and then you try to interpret it in the language we've been developing. So, okay, good. So let's try to take this action and vary it with respect to x of lambda, and then use the principle of least action to find the equivalence of motion. Okay, so what's the variation of s? So delta s is, well, minus m. Then we've got something under a square root. Okay, so we'll get a factor of half times the square root of the denominator times the variation of whatever was in the square root. Okay, now let's write down the variation of what was in the square root. The variation of what was in the square root was minus delta g alpha beta dx alpha by d lambda dx beta by d lambda. Okay. I'm just going to drop this out so I can continue this working across the board. Minus 2. Because the variation with respect to each of these will give you the same thing, clearly. G alpha beta d delta x alpha by d lambda dx beta by d lambda. Right? Now, what is this delta g alpha beta? This is the change in g because you've changed x a little bit. Okay? So I want to write it in terms of delta x, so we write this as minus del g alpha beta by del x theta delta x theta. And so as to ease our the equation of motion, I change this dummy index alpha to the same dummy index that we have there on this theta. Okay, so this is the variation of the action. Now we want to set this variation to 0 But you remember when you have variations that are differentiated in Lagrangian mechanics, before equating anything to zero, you transfer all the derivatives to the other side. Okay? So let's write that. So delta s is equal to minus m by 2 into, now we'll transform this derivative onto everything else. Okay? So that's d by d lambda of 1 by square root of this stuff, so whatever's inside the square root, you know, I won't write it, times 2 dx beta by dx beta by d lambda multiple. Yeah. That's this stuff. Everything in this bracket is going to be multiplied by delta x. And the other term is just simple. It's minus okay, we're out of yellow drop, so I'm going to switch to orange, not because okay. There's no significance. dg alpha beta by dx theta dx alpha by d lambda dx beta by d into delta theta is equal to 0. Okay, this we want to set to 0. As usual, by the principle of least action, the only way that this can be 0 for arbitrary delta x theta is for this thing to vanish pointwise. So we've derived an equation of motion. The equation of motion that we've derived is d by d lambda of 1 by square root of minus g alpha beta x beta dot dx beta by d lambda minus half g alpha beta del g alpha beta by del x beta, okay, into d x alpha by d lambda d x beta. And I've forgotten here the 1 by square root. That was also there. So there was the 1 by the same square root is equal to 0. This one was already there for this. the other thing I divide by will combine with this. Okay? So what I've said is that in terms of this new variable S, or maybe I should call it tau, because it's a proper time
for our physical motion.
In terms of this new variable tau, what I've got is the equation v to x beta by v tau squared. Okay. Minus, what was this? Del g alpha beta by del x beta to the half dx alpha by d tau dx beta by d tau is equal to 0. Okay? Now, this is not too bad. It's not a terrible-looking equation. But the question that you might immediately ask is it covariant? Do we get the same answer when we use different coordinate systems? Now, basically, we've just spent the last lecture and a half developing a theory of covariant differentiation. So if this thing is covariant, it should be expressible in our language. Okay, so let's try to do that. Let's first stare at this. See, this quantity here is the same as the following. Now, this quantity here is the same as Square roots that we talked about. So I convert this all into d by ds. That part was correct. Okay? But now in this d by ds, there's a term where I take d by ds of this g. Okay? So the additional term I get from there is a term that will couple with this guy. So this guy was minus half dg alpha beta by dx theta dx alpha by dx d lambda ds dx beta by ds. Added to that, I get a term which I, when I differentiate this. So there I use the chain rule, so I get plus del g theta beta by del x phi let me call that del x alpha times dx beta by ds, this was already here, times dx alpha by ds. What?
D
lambda. I've combined these square roots.
So it's tau.
Tau. Okay, so I've got this, and then plus the thing that I get by direct differentiation. Okay, so that's plus g theta beta d2x beta by d downstream. That is equal to zero. Okay, and now this is accurately what I wrote down before. Let's see that. You see, this quantity is the same as theta. This quantity is the same as half minus del theta of g alpha beta dx. Alpha plus del alpha g beta theta plus del beta g alpha theta multiplying dx alpha by d lambda dx beta by d lambda. Tau. Thank you. Why is this the same? This term here gives this term. That's obviously the same. And these two terms give the same. Sorry?
There is beta beta is contracted. I think theta theta is contracted. Well, the second term.
Yeah?
The upper left.
Upper left.
Second term.
Second term.
Theta is your free index.
Theta is the free index.
Okay, no, sorry.
Right. Okay, these two terms keep the same thing because they just equal to each other under a flip of dummy variables. Beta, theta, each contracted these things. Okay, so you get whatever you get from any one of these, and what you get from any one of these is precisely this. Okay, so what have we concluded? We've concluded that our equation here takes the form d by d tau of dx alpha by d tau plus gamma alpha beta beta dx beta by d tau dx theta by d tau is equal to zero. Okay? But note that this was precisely the rule for covariant differentiation of a vector. Okay? You take the derivative and add the gamma term with a plus sign. Okay? So, what this is telling you, another way of saying this, is that if you take if you define d by d time, okay, as equal to dx alpha by d tau times d alpha. Okay, so this is an ordinary covariant derivative, and you dot it with the tangent vector of along your world line, then this equation is saying that with this definition, we get d by d tau of x of dx alpha by d tau. Okay, or be completely explicit, the geodesic, this equation of motion for a particle is dx alpha by d tau d alpha of dx beta by d tau. Okay? Since tau is a Lorentz is a coordinate invariant object. Okay? And since this differentiation here is also coordinate covariant, what this gives you is one vector set of equations, and this vector of equations transforms covariant. What I want you to note here is that this gamma, being this formula, appeared directly, okay, in our computation. Okay? So, irrespective of all the other mathematics we did, okay, this is the correct equation of motion if you define a covariant derivative with our formula for gamma. Okay? So, you know, in the end, it will be things like this that will be... Well, okay, fine. Okay, I think, apart from questions and comments for today's lecture, we should close here. Keep it on full. Any questions or comments at that point? Discuss. Equation in arbitrary parameterization. So, in terms of our arbitrary parameterization, let's write it out. So, this was dx alpha by d lambda square root of, well, the square root we don't even need to write. It's just over on the side. But the important thing is here is d alpha of 1 by square root g alpha beta x alpha dot x beta dot dx beta. Okay, let's call this AB. Part of the problem with general relativity is you soon run out of misses. Now we've written in terms of arbitrary.